Next, let's look at the global carbon cycle. Carbon obviously is essential for life, not only in DNA and protein, but also in the carbohydrates we eat. And carbon also cycles between the atmosphere, the oceans, and the soils. Constantly, the plants on Earth are photosynthesizing, and they're converting CO2 into plant material, and that's now in the form of living material. Some of the plant material is lost and then absorbed into the soil. Through time, plant material and other biological material may also be absorbed into the earth in the form of fossil fuels. As we'll see shortly, petroleum comes from phytoplankton, coal comes from dead plants. So ultimately, from photosynthesis, CO2 is being removed from the atmosphere and then absorbed in various forms in the soil. There's also an exchange of carbon from the atmosphere into the ocean. So the ocean absorbs the CO2 that's in the air, but also it fizzes a bit and lets some off. But there's a bit of a net loss of CO2 into the oceans each year because the water is a sponge for CO2. Again, some of this is now being taken out in the form of petroleum. So we have this back and forth, back and forth. Naturally, the soils may give off some carbon as there's decomposition of the plant material or old peat and partially preserved forms of carbon in the soil. So there's always been a back and forth. Here's another source out of the earth is volcanoes. Volcanic gases can also emit carbon dioxide. And so CO2 has always gone back and forth. So photosynthesis, ocean uptake are two natural systems that take carbon dioxide out of the air. And there's always been a pretty rough balance between the amount of carbon dioxide taken out of the air and returned. However, currently, we're seeing a huge disruption to this natural cycle because we have systematically sought out these sources of carbon that are underneath the earth, and we're using them as fuels. So fossil fuels are being burnt. Carbon dioxide is now being systematically put back into the air. And through deforestation, as we knock down the rainforests and clear land for schools and parks and villages, that's killing trees, and that's taking carbon dioxide from a normal plant system to bare earth. This again generates carbon dioxide going into the air. So there's been, on average, a certain amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, about 750 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide has typically been in the atmosphere, and a similar amount in the ocean. But we're adding CO2 to the atmosphere like crazy right now. With deforestation, about 25% of what we're adding each year is because of trees that are being knocked down. Their carbon dioxide is now being liberated to go directly into the air. That has an added problem, though, because now the trees are not there to absorb photosynthesis in the next year. So by knocking down trees, we're preventing the normal reabsorption of CO2 out of the atmosphere. In addition, our own machinery and our own lifestyle requires fossil fuels. So 15% of the CO2 that's being thrown into the air comes from our transportation and 20% from our power plants. Now, if we look at this again, with what's happening between the energy that comes in from the sun, energy is ultimately radiated back out to space as heat, okay? But if we have too much of certain materials in the air, what are called greenhouse gases absorb the heat and they don't let it radiate back into space. Carbon dioxide is the most abundant that's being produced by human activities, and also nitrous oxide. Another very powerful greenhouse gas is methane, which is being produced by agriculture and also in the production of coal and gas. And what we want to look at is what happens when we add too many of these into the air. Now, as long ago as 1820, nearly 200 years ago, Joseph Fourier suggested that the Earth's atmosphere acted like a greenhouse, blocking heat returning to space. He said if we didn't have this this layer of air above the Earth's surface, every night all the heat that was absorbed by the sun would just radiate back out into space, so that the atmosphere was a bit like a blanket. John Tyndall in 1859 said, well, you know, actually there's certain gases that are responsible for that effect. Nitrogen, N2, is transparent to heat. Sunshine comes in, and if the atmosphere is nothing but nitrogen, it would go right back out. Likewise with oxygen. But carbon dioxide, it was carbon dioxide that was capturing the heat that would keep the Earth a little bit warmer than it should be at night. In 1896, this unpronounceable Scandinavian fellow said, you know, we're adding a lot of CO2 into the atmosphere right now. CO2 is a greenhouse gas. It blocks the escape of heat. And if we're producing more CO2 because we're burning coal, there's the Industrial Revolution, well, we might be facing long-term problems because less heat will be radiated out each night than normal, and this could cause global warming. So what's been happening to CO2 around the world ever since the Industrial Revolution? Now, this rather complex video has a lot going on, and I want to introduce you to it before I get it started. First is we have a map, and on this map we have a number of different monitoring sites where people have been measuring how much CO2 is available in the air 1 month to the next since 1979. Okay? And these sites are going to be shown over here. There's some at the south, there's one at the South Pole, there's one in Hawaii, and there's some in northern Alaska. So this is going from the southern hemisphere through the tropics through the northern hemisphere. Okay? And so what we're going to see on this left-hand side is how the CO2 varies from month to month, every month, from 1979 up to the present. Now on the right, we're going to see an aggregate of what the total global CO2 was, and that's going to go month to month. Okay, and what you're going to notice on both of these is that this is going to go up and down a little bit through the season. And this will show kind of a stair step up as well, because that's also reflecting the patterns through the season. So I think we're ready to go. So in 1979, we had only 336 parts per million. And you can see that through time, this whole line is rising from the South Pole to the North Pole. The rise and fall is higher in the Northern Hemisphere. That's because there's a lot more industrial activity up here. Now on the right, you can see this sort of yo-yo going along. And again, you have this annual cycle. During the spring and summer, plants are taking CO2 out of the air. During the winter, nothing can take the CO2 out, so it's all being added by industry. Okay? So overall, though, what we're seeing, though, is these are rising, and they're rising. They started at only 336 parts per million in 1979, and we're now up to 1993, and we're already up to about 360 parts per million. Notice also we're getting more and more monitors around the world, because everybody wants to know what's happening with CO2. We're getting new measurements now from Northern Hemisphere, Southern Hemisphere, Asia, all over the place. And you can see it's just going up and up and up all the time. Now we're up to 2001, and we're up to 370, and we're still rising. Getting some pretty wide swings here from month to month, but the overall pattern is up and up. And notice how at the South Pole, there's no industry down there. There's no plants. So that's just CO2 that's been escaping and moving all over the surface of the Earth. Okay? It's catching up, and we're going up to nearly 400 parts per million. Now this 400 parts per million is pretty much a scary limit, because a lot of the atmospheric scientists predict that once we get above 400 parts per million, we're going to see significant rises in global temperature. Now the right-hand chart is extrapolating backwards. There are other measures besides that measure in Hawaii and other places. Now it's extending backwards in time. So this is going back over the centuries based on various indirect measures of CO2 that are pretty reliable and accurate. And you can see that back in 1500, the typical CO2 was only about 278 parts per million. Now, on the right hand, it's extending back even further. These are estimates of CO2 based on ice cores. These are based on ice cores taken out of Antarctica. Notice that we're getting, as we go way back into deep time, we're looking at changes over tens of thousands of years, that carbon levels would show a cycle. And a lot of people talk about natural variation in the amount of carbon dioxide in the air. And yes, that's true. There has been natural variation. And it went from about 200 parts per million up to nearly 300 parts per million. But never before in the last 800,000 years did it get up here to nearly 400,000. We're in a new realm, never seen in the last 800,000 years. Now, that's CO2, and CO2 is a greenhouse gas. Sunlight can pass in through the Earth's atmosphere, it hits the CO2, gets converted to heat to some extent, and it can't get out. The CO2 traps it like a blanket. In this video, we're now going to look at the changes in temperature. This is just over the last 200 years. We've got the temperatures from the early 1800s. Again, this is month by month. Measurements back then were restricted largely to Europe and North America. As time goes on, we'll see more and more thermometers have been set out around the world. So our measures of global temperature are based on a broader set of instruments. Now we're up to the 1830s. You notice that the temperature hasn't shown any particular trend. And by current standards, it's pretty cool most of the time back then. It might be one or two warm years like this one, then it's back and it's cool most of the time. Now we're getting into the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution, somewhere in there. And there's not a whole lot of change detectable at first. Temperature stays reasonably within the realm. There's none of those really, really cold years like in 1810. But it's not too seriously bad. But now, starting in 1900, we're going to see more and more above average years, above the long-term average. Several years there in the 19-teens. Again in the 1920s and 30s. And a persistent long period in the 1940s. Now, some of these changes in temperature are actually because there were volcanic explosions. The volcanoes not only throw out greenhouse gases, but they also throw out a lot of dust, and the dust can block the sun's rays. So after a period, there was actually a fair amount of volcanic activity in the 1950s. Now we're going up again, and now it's getting serious. The 1980s, 1990s, it's never below normal. It's always up. And now we're into a realm that's never been seen before in the last 200 years. And we're staying up there. We're not going back and forth. We're staying at high and getting higher on average. So this is the actual global warming that's been predicted since the late 19th century. If we look at temperatures since the late 1880s, there's been this overall climate change. The Earth has been getting warmer. And if we look at where this warming has been taking place, it's strongest at high latitudes, that is up near the North Pole and down near the South Pole. These are furthest away from the direct sun rays. And so what we see, if we look at the average change in temperature in the Northern Hemisphere, it's been extraordinary from about Minnesota, where we're at about 45 degrees north, all the way up to the North Pole. That's where most of the warming has been taking place. And likewise, there's been considerable warming in the deep south part of the planet, down near the South Pole. Now, if you had a system where the heat is mostly coming in at the equator from the sun, but you put a blanket on it, you'd expect the heat now to spread over the whole Earth's surface. Okay? That's what you get with the greenhouse. It's not just with the sun striking directly, but it's where the heat cannot escape anymore because of that blanket on top. If we once again look at a much longer time series, going back hundreds of thousands of years, we can use the gases that are trapped in Antarctic ice to measure how much methane, carbon dioxide, and nitrous oxide were in the atmosphere at different times in history. And like carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, these also showed cyclical variation through time. There was natural variation. But like carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide and methane have never been this abundant until now. We know for sure that variations in these greenhouse gases affect global climate in a very large, profound way. Ice ages coincide with periods of time when CO2 and nitrous oxide are low. As carbon dioxide recovers and goes back up, the ice would recede. We see a link between temperature and these greenhouse gases in the historic record, but the worrying thing in terms of our perceptions about what's going on in the present time, there's always been a lag. Temperature does rise in response to rising CO2 and methane, but our temperatures have not yet caught up to what we would predict on the basis of the methane, CO2, and nitrous oxide currently in the atmosphere from human activities. As we look at the carbon cycle, we know that carbon has always moved between below ground and above ground pools. Carbon dioxide is taken out of the atmosphere by plants, but carbon has never before been so systematically transferred from the ground into the atmosphere. We are approaching a tipping point. We're now about to see feedbacks between greenhouse gases and rising temperatures that really give a sense of urgency to trying to control carbon emissions.